Good evening, everyone, and welcome to another webinar at the National Library of Scotland. My name is Kenny Redpath, and I'm the Events Officer at the Library. As part of our Nature series of events, it's my pleasure this evening to introduce Gael Wilkinson, who's here to give a talk called Beekeeping for Beginners, A Personal Journey. Gael has quite a CV, starting her career in the live music industry, working with artists such as REM, U2, Prince, and Oasis, and then in the development and sales arm of Scottish Television. Gael moved with her family to Oman in the Middle East. Finding herself at loose end in the desert, she started an interior design store and import-export business. After a move to the Far East and then Brazil, she returned to Scotland and went back to university to complete her marketing degree. Since then, she has been working as a digital marketing consultant under her brand banner, Kin. Over the last 2 years, she has been religiously buying lottery tickets in the hope of leaving the 9-to-5 and become a full-time beekeeper. I wish you so much luck, Gael. So now, please welcome Gael.
Oh, yeah, good. Hi, thanks for that, Kenny. So, hello, everybody. I'm Gael. Don't know where everybody is. I can't see everybody. So if you decide to wander off, it's completely fine. So at the moment, my real job is a marketing consultant, also a beekeeper. I can't say part-time because if anyone out there is already a beekeeper, you know that they just completely take over your life. I'm also not a natural public speaker, so if I suddenly go quiet or lose my train of thought, please bear with me. So a couple of years ago, I decided to cut down on my client list and I have some more me time. And I was looking for something outdoorsy as a hobby. I used to run a lot and a knee injury had put the kibosh on that. So what I actually wanted was chickens, but because we have a little crazy terrier, that was a no-go. And I follow a vineyard down in the south of England on Instagram, and they started keeping bees. And I just thought, wow, because I'd always thought that beekeeping was something that very wealthy people on big country estates did, or very old men on allotments. And I'd always been fascinated by bees. I think as a feminist, the idea of a efficient female-led society quite appealed to me. So as soon as I started to get interested in honeybees, they were just everywhere, popping up in social media feeds. They were at the Highland Show, they were on Landward, they were on the news, they were on Countryfile. Someone was even keeping them on a roof terrace in central London, and I just thought, right, a beehive in my garden is the way forward for me. So my next step was to start researching online, and I quickly realised that everything I thought I knew about honeybees and beekeeping was complete rubbish. So I'd been recommended quite a few books in my research, so I got onto Amazon, got them delivered, and I just couldn't put them down. I was up all night reading them. There are a few books, a blog, bits and pieces that you can get a list at the end, I definitely recommend. So the more I read, the more I realised that this was for me. But how do you start and where do you get bees from? And I just thought, surely you can't just go and buy them on the internet. Sort of turns out you can buy them on the internet, but it's much better to buy bees locally from your local area that can be that are used to your weather, the local forage, your seasons. So during my online research, I came across the Dunfermline Beekeepers Society. Every area in the UK certainly has their own beekeeping society. And I just dropped them an email and they were just great. They were super friendly. They invited me along to the group apiary that's close to my house. And when I got there, I realised that it is a really mixed bunch and there are lots of successful women beekeepers out there. And if you're thinking of getting into beekeeping or would just like to know or learn more, I would definitely recommend your local association as the place to start. They're just brilliant with advice. You can borrow stuff if you need anything urgently, and they're great at buying in bulk, and they sell things on at a discounted price, like honey jars and bits and bobs. So when I was there, I got talking with another visitor called John, who was actually a bee farmer. I just found this so fascinating. It was like a little secret world that I didn't know existed, that goes on in a parallel universe all around us. And when I got that suit on for the first time and they opened up the hive and I looked inside, that was it. I was completely hooked. So John, the bee farmer, offered to sell me a colony of bees. He said, oh, they'll be ready in a few weeks, Gael. And with 50 years experience under his belt, he also offered to be my mentor. And I think in my beekeeping journey, that's been one of my luckiest breaks, because he's just been brilliant. And I'm not sure what I would do without him. But I'm sure he can do without me panic calling him all the time. John actually breeds bees. And Buckfast Queens, which is a strain of bee favoured by honey producers, and he sends them all over the country, sometimes in the post. And his advice is always very solid, and he's quite a pragmatic guy. He's always telling me, don't worry, the bees know best. And he's a big believer in not interfering too much and letting the bees sort themselves out. And I think I am very slowly starting to learn the art of patience, but it doesn't come naturally to me, I have to say, which is probably why I completely bypassed the year-long recommended course and went straight from books to the website of a retailer with my list. I bought the suit, I bought hive, I bought smoker, I bought all the bits and bobs I thought I'd need. I didn't realise how much more I would end up buying over the next couple of years. Happily it's calmed down now, but I am always looking to buy another hive. So the slide you're looking at now is actually my shed. I took this picture yesterday and almost everything in it has been used over the summer. So everything's kind of chucked in there at the moment, all waiting to do a deep clean, bit of a repaint over the winter. That'll keep me busy, and so everything's ready for spring. So this is a picture of my very first hive. It's made of wood, and it was an absolute nightmare to build. It came in a big box with about 1,000 pieces and zero instructions. And I vowed I would never build another one, and I haven't. I've now changed over to poly hives, which chain of thought with that is they're much better for our cold, damp Scottish winters. So hopefully I'll find out soon, because I've got three going into this winter, all poly. Bees seem pretty happy in there at the moment. But they are brilliant to make because they slot together in about 3 minutes, and it's a complete game changer. The other sort of hive that's going about at the moment, there's a lot of talk online, is flow hives. I think especially since David Beckham got one, and he's had that all over his social media feed. And this is a system where the honey flows out of the hive straight into the jar. I'm not totally up to speed with the product and how they work, but the main thing I know is they're not great for Scotland because we're just too cold. It's not warm enough to let that honey flow out. So most people that I know have what is called a national hive, which is what you're seeing in the picture. It's a standard size, and it just makes life so much easier because you can fit parts together, everything slots up, you can change things around. I really like the poly hives are exactly the same size, so you can even mix and match between poly and wood if you really had to, if you're in a bit of a palaver. So I just want to talk about the general parts of the hive. So at the very bottom, there's the landing board. Some people call it an alighting board, but my bees only ever seem to land on it. They fly straight out the door. These are pretty personal preference, and I just really like the look of them. So all of my hives have a landing board. The next part is the floor, and certainly in my area, most floors have a mesh bottom which allows air to flow all year round and any moisture or debris from the hive to come out. I keep mine open all year round unless we've got a really bad storm coming. The bees seem to prefer it that way. Then the next one up is the brood box. I think Joanne's got another slide for you. This is here. So this is where the queen and most of the bees live. She'll lay her eggs here and the workers will tend to them and store their food. This is basically what hive looks like when you take the lid off and you go to look inside. And this is what I saw the very first time I visited the Dunfermline Beekeepers apiary, and I was just absolutely fascinated with what was all going on. So normally a queen excluder sits on top, which is a mesh, and that allows the bees to move up into the super. I'll get to that bit in a minute. There you go, this is the frame of super. This is me, super cheesy, extracting my very first honey. I was so chuffed. That was earlier this year. And the super keeps the queen down in the brood box where she does all her egg laying and lets the bees go up into the super so that they can create honey up there. You don't want the two to mix. If the queen gets up in your super, starts laying eggs up there, that honey is no longer fit for human consumption. But the whole honey thing is the added bonus, definitely, of beekeeping. And I didn't sort of realise how much I would love the whole getting your first honey. And I tell you, there's nothing tastes better than your own honey. Depending on how much nectar flow and the plants in your area, you can put more and more boxes of super on top. I've seen some in photographs with 5 and 6, and although here in 5, the most I've ever got is 2. But if they really fill them up, you can get up to like 30 pounds of honey out of each super, which is quite a few jars. And I keep a little store for ourselves, but I also sell my honey locally. And then on top of that, there's usually a crown board, keeps the heat in, keeps the bees in. I like a clear perspex one because I'm nosy and I like to peek inside all the time. And then your roof on the top. And I always keep my hives strapped down with ratchet straps because we're quite windy here. It comes up the River Forth and hits the hives. So I've got my hive, I've got all my bits and bobs. Here I am, all the gear, no idea, and it's at this point I decide I'm going to tell my husband about my new scheme. And he had an absolute fit, and he'd only just managed to talk me out of the chickens. And it turns out he's super allergic to stings, and our back garden was a no-go. And I've since discovered that unless you have a large back garden are very understanding neighbours, preferably none at all. Gardens aren't always the best place for bees. Some people are lucky, they never have any problems. Lots of people keep their bees in their garden and they're absolutely fine. But you should always have a plan B of where you could move your bees to if you get any issues. So once I'd come out of my huff that I couldn't have them in the garden, I went for a drive around our village looking for a good spot, and I just started knocking on doors. To be honest, there's some lovely private country estates around us, and I've always wanted a nosy at the houses. So I went around, knocked doors, gave everybody my number, and every single one of them came back and said yes. So I went with the one that was within walking distance of my house, and it's just been perfect. I now have this little unused cobble yard. It's south facing, it's super private. It has a big stone wall on one side and the back of a barn on the other, so it's sheltered. And it has gorgeous views over the Forth and all the Forth bridges. So I like to think that my bees have a prime location. There's also lots of local forage, which is very important. If you're in an area with mostly cereal crops, their bees are going to struggle. So the estate and the local farmer are super supportive of the bees. They love having them around. They've in the last couple of years have set aside 3 different 1-acre plots for nature. They're very eco-minded. There are also plans to replant traditional hedgerows, which have been removed over the years. And that's just fantastic for pollinators, because this year the hawthorn flowered for weeks in that warm spring and it was brilliant. And I just love that my bees are playing a very small part in developing the native wildflower meadows that they're planting. So that's been great. And This little yard has been my lockdown saviour this year, and when the weather was hot, I could legitimately go visit my livestock, because in the UK, bees are classed as livestock by DEFRA, and sometimes I can just sit there for hours and watch the girls come and go, it's so mindful. And I'd walk the dog, and just sometimes I'd drop off and have a wee snooze, and other times I would say, oh, I'll just go there on my way to pick my son up at Tesco, and then completely forget. So I just, it's been fantastic to have that escape this year. And that's a really nice side of beekeeping, although things are not always super calm around the beehives, I have to be honest. And depending on the weather, they can be quite cranky. This year before, I don't know where everybody's from, I can't see that, but if you were in the east of Scotland, you would know that we had this massive lightning storm back in, I think it was the beginning of September. And I didn't realize that was coming. I knew a storm was coming, but they were so aggressive. And I had decided to check the ties were fine because I thought it was going to be windy. And when I got there, they just went bonkers. And I had to sort of do a bit of a drop, roll, run maneuver a couple of times. I have to say, it was a little bit scary. They just completely chased me out of the yard. And one of the hives was queenless and was awful for a few weeks until they were all, they got back into their usual routine. Because bees do not like being queenless. Their order and routine is completely upset, and the queen releases pheromones that kind of binds the colony together. And when that goes, the workers are not happy until they can create another queen and order can return. There are various reasons bees can become aggressive, which is possibly one of the reasons why not to have them in your garden. But being queenless and the weather are the main issues that I've come across. And believe me, no one wants aggressive bees. So at this point, I have my hive built, I have painted my bee stand to keep them off the ground, and it's all sitting there empty in the yard, and I was just dying for my bees to arrive. So this is a picture of me of the day they came. I was grinning like a Cheshire cat. I just couldn't believe I'd been up all night, I was so excited. John brought them and we checked everything over and we installed them. From the box he brought them in into my lovely freshly painted blue hive. I wasn't quite so chipper when they swarmed 2 weeks later, but you know, these things do happen. So I started off with one hive, and there are various schools of thought on this. As many people say, it's best to start with two. You can come back from one colony failure, you can compare them against each other. Obviously this means double the outlay at the beginning. And it isn't cheap, but once you've bought your kit, you'll have it forever, I would say that. So I went with one, but genuinely with hindsight, I'd say two would have been better. So I got my bees in June, which is the normal time that small nucleus colonies are available. In your new colony, as John pointed out to me, you should find a marked queen, plenty of young workers, and perhaps a few drones. So those are the three types of bees that you're going to find in a honeybee hive. The first one, and almost 99% of the bees that are in that hive are going to be your worker bees. And these worker bees are all female and they do almost everything for the hive. They only live for 45 days, which really isn't long, so 6 weeks. But from birth to death, the worker bee moves through kind of a list of jobs that they do. So from the minute they hatch out of their little bit of honeycomb, they would clean that out, ready for the queen to lay another egg in it. They also tend the queen, they feed and look after the larvae, which is the baby bees, they clean the hive, they guard the colony, they build the honeycomb. There's even mortician bees that take out the dead. And one of the last jobs they do is they fly out and they collect the food, so being nectar or pollen. And the workers also decide, you know, they decide what is going on in that hive. if they no longer have faith in the queen and they plan to replace her, or if they decide that that hive's become too busy, the colony's got too big and they want to go, they will swarm. So this is a picture of me this summer with my very first swarm that I helped John, my mentor, achieve. We just happened to be on our way to one of his apiaries that's nearby, and I spotted it landing in a tree. And I have to say, it was an absolute belter for my first swarm. It was huge, and you could hear the noise. It was like a jet engine. But I did end up standing up a big ladder with some lethal tree pruners to cut it down while John stood underneath with a big box. So he managed to get a whole new hive of free bees that day. So the worker bees are the bees you'll see on your flowers in the garden, and the bees that make the honey that we love. The next one was the drones. I don't know, Joanne, if we can go back to that picture of the three. Yes, the drones. Now, the drones are all male, and they are made by the queen when she lays an unfertilized egg, and that is her decision. So mating is a drone's only purpose. Sorry, guys. And his life can be short and eventful, or rather dull, but it's only going to last one summer. The drones last maximum 90 days. The process of mating is going to kill the drone, so he only ever gets one shot. And if he's not lucky enough to mate throughout the summer, as it comes to the tail end of the year, the worker bees will kick him out. They don't want to share the food with them. They have no purpose then. And they're quite ruthless, and they'll actually drag them out. I've sat and watched them thinking, what's going on? They drag them out, hoof them over the edge, and then the guards will not let them back in. It's a little bit sad, but they're then left to die of cold or hunger. And that's it, guys. Sorry, you're out the door. But I'm quite fond of the drones. I think I like them because they don't have a sting. But when I see them starting to die off, I always know that it's a sure sign that summer's ending and the season's almost over. This year, within a day of starting to see dead drones outside the hives, the first leaves on the lime trees next to the apiary started to turn, and you just know winter's coming. And even though this has been the oddest year, there's absolutely nothing you can do to slow it. The other, here we go. I don't know if that will play. Yes, this is a little video of one of my queens. I think this is actually Carrie. It's my very first queen. It's a bit of a jolty video. It's not playing great, but if you can spot her, she's got a squint yellow mark. So basically, in a hive, there can only be one queen, and she is the mother of all the bees in the colony. Before I got into bees, I had always thought that the queen was in charge. She's at the top, a bit like our sort of queen, but she's not. She's important because without her, the colony will die. The workers only live for 6 weeks. So if there's no queen creating new bees, the colony is going to dwindle until there's too few to survive. They'll die off. But all decisions are made by the female workers as a collective. It's a real democracy. Quite how we do it, we don't know. No one knows, although everybody's desperately trying to, for years and years, trying to find out. And it's these things that fascinate me about bees. So other things that I have learned about queens. Once she's born, she goes off on mating flights once she gets a really nice, warm, dry day. And once she has mated successfully, she will stay inside the hive and with the colony, and she'll never actually visit a single flower, which I find a bit sad, really. But she's got her role. And when I started with bees, I thought it would be a lovely wee hobby, but there's some quite dark parts to it. It can be quite harsh. These girls can be harsh. And as I've already mentioned, there can only be one queen. If a queen hatches and there's another older queen in there inside the hive, the new queen will find her and kill her. And that old queen is her mother. So if the bees have created more than one new queen, maybe like a little backup, the first one that hatches will kill her sisters by stinging them through the cell before they're even born. So it is quite ruthless. if two hatch at the same time, they will pipe. It's like a sort of children's tooting whistle. And basically that's them shouting to any other queens in the hive to say, I'm coming for you and we are going to fight for this colony. And usually you're just left with one, and that then they start to lay and it all goes on. I've heard the tooting once in one of my own hives. It's a very odd sound, but quite exciting, and just another thing that I find absolutely fascinating about bees. Queens have also been the bane of my beekeeping journey, and I think they can be for a lot of beekeepers. Not only do they just die occasionally, they cannot return from mating flights, they can just disappear, they can be killed by their own daughters, they leave with the swarm, they can also not hatch at all when you're waiting on one to hatch, which is so disappointing when you've tried to be so patient for 3 weeks and you open it up to find the queen and it hasn't even hatched. So I've had quite a lot of queen drama in my couple of years in beekeeping, but I genuinely never tired of spotting them when I'm doing my hive inspections. This one here, Carrie, I had to take a little video of it because that frame that she's sitting on, the frame of wax, was quite quiet, so you could see her. But whenever I spot the queen, I get a little heart rush. I really like it because to me, they are the heart of the colony. Like I was saying, this is Queen Carrie, and she was my first queen that came in the photograph you saw earlier. And she's just always been my favourite because she's my first. But poor John the bee farmer, he's had to come good with me a few times for spare queens when I've had queen drama. I had to laugh when I got a text saying from him, I was in Tesco one day and the text just said, queen under doormat. And when I got home, there was a little cage with a queen, some worker bees attendants under my doormat. So my husband's like, this is insane. What is going on? So not everybody does name their queens, but I always name mine. And I name them after dream dinner guests. So right now I have Michelle Obama, Carrie Bradshaw, which you've all met, Joanna Lumley, and there was a Diana, but weirdly, she was just a nightmare from start to finish. She was killed by her own colony, which is slightly prophetic, really. But there's not going to be another Diana. Whichever one comes along next is going to get a new name. So from what I've read from many sources and a lot of folklore about bees, you should always tell your bees what's going on in your life. So births, deaths, weddings. So right now I have been telling them everything that's going on. I did pop by yesterday and tell them they were about to be internet stars. Sometimes it's weird when if I say something in the door of the hive, you actually get a buzz. It's like a pulse. Because right now when it's cold, the bees are in a tight cluster, like a little ball of tiny penguins. And I know that they've heard me and that they're happy to be informed. And it's this connection to the bees that's really surprised me. I just love them. I think if I lost a colony, that's touch wood, not happened to me yet, I'd be devastated. And I can imagine people think I'm mad and that they're just insects, but I'm not bothered. To me, each hive is a whole living entity, and I just love having a little part and helping them survive in what is often, especially this year, a very difficult changing world. It's not always in the bees' favour. I think that looking, but so this is my apiary just now. And you can see the poly hives are slightly different, and obviously because of lockdown this summer I had lots of time to do lots of painting. I think that looking back over my two full years, it's been fantastic, and yes, I'm sure I've made lots of mistakes, but I've also learned so much, it's crazy. I'm going into this winter with three really healthy, strong colonies. I know there's four hives there, but the two in the middle were combined a few weeks ago, because Diana was in the original blue hive. So I'm going into the winter with three healthy, strong colonies and a decent store of honey on my shelf. And into the next season, I think, comes spring with a lot more confidence and knowledge. I'm hoping to expand my hives up to 5 or 6 next year, but really that will be up to the bees because the bees know best. I hope you found that interesting and thank you so much for listening.